Good morning, everyone. Welcome home. And for those that were here yesterday, wasn't it fun? We had an extra day of church for those that were missing yesterday. Got together, ate hot dogs. The men's, our Crossroads group, did a phenomenal job in entertaining us, and we thank you. And the women and everybody else that brought salads and cookies and other desserts, we thank you as well. Now give yourselves a round of applause for such a great turnout and demonstration of what God's love truly does mean as we gather. So we come back together on this glorious day, and welcome back home. It seems like it's been a long time since we were together, and it's only been a week. Please, let us draw our hearts and minds together in prayer as you are able. Gracious and loving God, we place ourselves here before you on this glorious day. Lord, we ask that you block out the world and its ways for just a few moments. Lord, help our hearts and minds to focus and concentrate on you and you alone during this brief hour. And may our hearts and minds unite in joy and in love as we go forward. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. We come to the time of our service where we raise up that we've seen God in our lives this week. Because God is always around us. But when we are focused on what we're seeing, he becomes more visible, not only in our lives, but in the lives of others that are around us. Would anybody like to talk about where they saw God in their lives this week? Harry, wait for the mic, please, so people at home can hear you.
Yesterday's picnic,
a great example of God's light. I don't know, he's got to give you a... He was cooking. We have another one. Judy.
I don't mean it. It's my teacher.
I know for sure that God is at work in our lives because after waiting and waiting and waiting, Ari is finally in a program that we think will fit her needs. You can't tell me that God doesn't answer prayer. The problem is sometimes it takes a long time. God is good all the time, and he is there.
Praise be to God. And now, let us join our hearts and minds as we enter into our announcements. Susie.
I believe Tim has an announcement. He is not having an announcement. We've covered the picnic yesterday and what a joy it was to gather. The only other one that's in the book is a reminder, and for anyone who wasn't here yesterday, we have a little collection box that is a free will offering for the folks in Hawaii. And it is, Bob is holding it up. It will also be at coffee hour for anyone who wants to stick something in as we think of those. Thanks. Any other announcements? We will do. Let's, if you would stand if you are able and join me for the call to worship. Let us give thanks to God and make known God's deeds among the people. We will sing praises to God, telling of God's beautiful works. Let the hearts of those who seek God rejoice. We seek the presence and strength of God continually. Let us seek, sing, and glorify God at this time and in this space. Our opening hymn is Here I Am. It's number 654. Thank you. Please be seated and join me in the unison prayer followed by the Lord's Prayer. God of grace and glory, in times of anxiety and fear, come to us. Remind us that you can calm the storms of life and enhance our faith. Help us to celebrate your grace that showers over us and to know that we can have new life through faith in Christ. Open the hearts of those who have yet to experience your grace and forgiveness. Infuse us with your Spirit that as we walk through the day, we might share the joy of knowing you with all people. Amen. And the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand as you are able. Please be seated.
Our gospel lesson this morning will be from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 22 through 33. Immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost," and they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed a strong wind, he became frightened and began to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "Ye of little faith, why do you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." So ends our lesson for this morning. May these words inspire our hearts and minds so as we go about our daily tasks this week, we demonstrate to the world and its peoples that God is here, God is present, and God has a handle on things. We just need to follow. May it be so. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we celebrate you. We celebrate being with you and amongst your people. Lord, as we gather our hearts and minds into this sacred space and time, We ask that the world and its ways stay out of our thoughts and minds for just a few moments. Lord, help us to concentrate on what is important, which is you in our lives. And may the words of my mouth and the reflections of our hearts reflect your true love for all of your children. In Jesus' name, amen. It's too quiet in here. Okay, who's got the cookies? The only time I've ever seen this many people this quiet is when it was cookie time, the downstairs. Okay, so nobody's eating them in the pews? It's just this quiet because it's this quiet. Okay. Then I'm going to ask a nice question that's not going to be a rhetorical question. It requires an answer. Can you walk on water? Bob says, nope. We got one with skis.
You can if it's frozen.
You can if it's frozen? Mm-hmm. Nobody's saying yes. Isn't that kind of amazing? Why does everybody go gravitate toward the no? Oh, I was going to go by that you were guys bought into the scientific thing that water and displacement and gravity and the weight on the water. And I mean, you're a teacher. Come on, go for the scientific. Yeah, you can. We can walk on water. All we need is the faith, the desire, in the willingness to do it. I mean, after all, Peter could walk on water. So what separates Peter from you? When Peter was there with Jesus, he had great faith. He never doubted that everything and anything was possible. He truly thought that it was a miracle from Jesus that enabled him to walk on water. Peter did not seem to understand that it was his faith in God and in Jesus that enabled the act of walking on water. And then the world in its ways interfered with that holy walk, as it always seems to do. You know, Matthew is loaded this morning with some important lessons for us. There's a lot of vignettes in here. A few words giving us great meaning. Jesus and Matthew are trying to draw us into this, to apply these lessons to our own lives. But before we start getting into the vignettes in great detail, let's first look at Jesus' actions. Because in my opinion, and in my belief, this was one of the most important reasons why Jesus came to the earth. You see, we all know that God is with us. But unfortunately for many, that's about as far as they can take it. Their faith does not allow them to go over that line. Jesus came, fully human, fully divine, to demonstrate to us, to simple, ordinary people, with eyes and ears, that actions, and seeing those actions take place, are important. So when we look at Jesus' actions, we start to understand a little bit more about God. And we definitely understand a lot more about Jesus. So, looking at Jesus' actions in response to what he needs at this moment is important. You see, after serving the people that were present, after serving the crowds, like most of us, Jesus is probably pretty tired, physically and spiritually. But he just doesn't leave his flock, does he? The first thing he does is he knows that his disciples are also very exhausted from the days of taking care of others. And he takes care of them first, sending them away for some rest. And he turns back to the people and he dismisses them. But you know, I looked at this vignette and I walked into that space a little bit. And I said, you know, I wonder what words that Jesus departed the crowd with. Because I don't believe in my heart that it was, y'all need to leave now. You don't gotta go home, but you gotta get out of here. Couldn't picture Jesus doing that. No, it hurts my heart leads me to believe that he blessed them, that he prayed over them as they departed, probably gave out some hugs and handshakes. In other words, just took time for the flock and what they needed. And then, and only then, did Jesus take care of his needs. Going off by himself to reflect, pray, and communicate with God. What lesson is Jesus trying to teach us during this time? If you hold as I believe that Jesus is fully human and fully divine, well, I think he needed some self-care. He needed some time to just come down a little bit. I know, I lost it. It's okay, though. You know, the world tells us that we're not supposed to take self-time or self-care. You cannot take time for yourself, is what the world tries to teach us and tell us. And we cannot take time for God. But if you're a disciple of Jesus and you follow what he is demonstrating to you, then you should be about and hear about the fact that taking time for you and God is important. For we need time to just sit, empty our minds, and we need time to prepare for the work that we are called to engage in. For Jesus, he climbs the mountain, not a mountain of teaching, but a mountain of communicating with God. Where and when do we take our time? Not a rhetorical question. How do you take your personal time for you and God?
Right here.
Do we leave other times? Do you get tired and you need those other times?
At night before I get in bed.
At night before you get in bed.
Every morning.
Every morning. My favorite time to commune with God. You know, in the old days, we used to have the blue laws. Now, I think every one of us in this room, no matter where you are on the age bracket, know about the blue laws. But to refresh your memory, the blue laws, Bob, is when your dealership could not open. It was a Sunday. All businesses were closed on Sunday. Now, I hope that people went to church, but I know many people didn't go to church. But it was a time of rest. It was a time for the family to come together. It was a time when we just held up our hands and we said, stop. desperately we need those times today. The times to just stop, take a deep breath, and shake off the anxiety of the world and become more. The next vignette we look at is the disciples being away from Jesus in a boat and being battered by waves. For Matthew, there was great symbolism in the meaning here. Let's look at it. For Matthew, the first thing was that they were facing the world without Emmanuel. God is with us. Jesus sent them away. The boat, for Matthew, was a representation of the church, the body, as the individuals were gathered within. They were tossed about in the storm, and it's a symbolic illustration for us of the ministry's journey that we are going on throughout history, where the church will be battered, yet the people and the disciples hold still. Then there's the ocean and the seas. Unlike today, our forefathers saw great danger in the oceans and in the seas. For Matthew, this is a representation of the evil in the world that is battering the boat. The forces of chaos that is coming against the forces of good. In biblical thought, being on the sea itself is a threat, representing all the anxieties and dark powers that threaten the goodness of the created order. For it was only with God and by God's goodness that the seas were contained. It's impossible for Jesus who meditates in the presence of God to be with the disciples during their journey. Yet he comes to them as he promised in the latest and in the darkest part of the night. For Matthew, the early church faces real physical danger. And he emphasizes the presence of Christ in and with the community in its mission. Jesus will walk with us across and over the evils of the world, and he will never leave us. A little boat for protection, which represents our church, the narrow walls that keep out the ways of the evils of the world and keeps it at bay, is not going to stop them. You see, we need the power and the authority of God through Christ and with the Holy Spirit as our God, as our guide and our advocate, to find our safety and purpose. For even in the worst of hurricanes and with all the chaos that is floating around us, we can find, and we do find, moments of peace and rest and love. Jesus calls to Peter to take heart and to come. In that moment, Peter's faith and belief, his biblical mind, defies the laws of gravity, and he walks toward Jesus on the water. The Lord spoke and said, "Do not be afraid. For I am here for and with you." That is what Jesus tells us. Do not be afraid, for I am here with you. Whatever you face with all the evils of the world that is taking place, I will not be separated from you if you want me here with you. So Peter walks to the Lord, demonstrating his great personal faith. He leaves the boat and he leaves his community. And then he sees the violence and the chaos of the storm, and he begins to sink. For Matthew, this held out a series of problems. For Matthew, the first problem was that he wanted proof of the presence of Christ. He wanted Christ to call him, come. He left the boat in his community. So he hung himself out there alone and by himself. And then he took his eyes off of Jesus for just that split second. And then everything happened. When all the evil of this world touches our lives, we might get caught in them. Jesus' response to Peter is the same response that he has for us sometimes, a very gentle and loving rebuke. You of little faith, why did you doubt? Why do we doubt? We ask the Lord for different things that we believe would make this trip in this world better for us. Better for us Christians, better for our neighbors. We invite, talk, and welcome God's children into this place of worship and fellowship. But we are standing against some massive evil that's taking place in the world, the divisions that are taking place. A house cannot be divided amongst itself and continue. The evil that's taking place in the world continues to draw people away from God and God's way. And they believe that it's the golden idols, it's the cell phones, it's the equipment that add value to their lives. We're losing the meaning of what life truly is. We have choices. We can be like Peter. We can ask God for proof. Or maybe we can just stay inside our boat and at proper times, we can come out into our community and the community that is around us and show them that by keeping faith in our Lord and keeping going in our missions and ministries, that we are making the world a better place. It's not going to happen all at once. It's not going to happen with the big things we do. It's going to happen with the little things we do. It's going to happen with the little cookouts that we have. It's going to happen with the little concerts we hold in here. It's going to happen when our good friend and missions chair drives us outside into the world just to help one or two people. Those are the changes that Jesus wants to see us making. Small ones, important ones. Because even in its darkest moments, even when we walk in pitch black, Jesus does not lose track of his children, his sheep. He knows who you are. And the light of God will and does surround you. The last thing they said is that when they worship Jesus is, truly, you are the Son of God. May we carry this into the world with us this week and bring it just a little bit more light. May it be so. Amen. Our next hymn will be, I Love to Tell the Story, number 480 in your hymnal. Please stand as you are able.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. God gives you and will continue to give you everything you need and everything you want. Maybe not packaged the way we would expect it to be packaged, but he does deliver on all of his promises to us. And what does he require? Truly nothing back from us. But we are committed to being Christians and going forward and helping people. And as Christians in this church, we make a promise of giving of our time, our talents, and our treasures back to Christ as we are able to further the missions and ministries of this house. And that's what we do. So at this time, if you have yet to make your morning offering, you will find the offering box receptacle in the back. Please you make your offering as you see fit. For those that are sitting at home and you would desire to make an offering, there is a PayPal button on your screen. Please hit it as you are able. And to remind everyone, there is also a free will offering being taken for Hawaii at this time. So please give as you can. Let our morning offering commence.
My help comes from my Maker, the Lord of
please rise as you are able. Gracious and holy God, we thank you for all the gifts that you give to us so freely and lovingly. We ask that you accept this token of our appreciation and love back to you. Lord, we seek the wisdom that only you can give to our leadership of how best to utilize these gifts, so that those that are hungry, those that are without, find the resources that are needed. We ask and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Please be seated. It's only 12 after. He's all red now. Andy, it's okay. It's okay. We come to the time that I consider to be one of the most precious and sacred gifts that God gives to us. The gift of community. The gift of our boat. In our body as we come together each and every week and as often as we can. These are the important things that we do. So we hold one another when things are bad and tough and we're facing the challenges of the world, and we celebrate with one another when things are glorious. That's what a community is about. That's what my brothers and sisters are about. It's glorious. So at this time, if you have a concern that is sitting on your heart, or you have a joy that needs to be celebrated, please raise it before God in our community so that we may be with you and walk with you.
Pray for that, whatever that situation that caused the fire engine to go up the street just now.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We have two. The good one is that last Sunday, Glenna wasn't here because she was at a baby shower in Maryland. Well, 3 days later, that knee went into labor. The other is not so happy. Our good neighbor, Mike, and had the baby, yes.
They had the baby, right? I like, just so you know, I'm going to interrupt him just for a minute, because I want to, the way he told me the story is, and then 3 days later, she had the baby. We were talking about you. Oh, you didn't know you had a baby 3 days ago.
The other one isn't so happy. Our wonderful neighbor, Mike Tarby, Cardi.
No last names.
Just in the last couple of days, he leaves a wife, a son, and his son's family.
Brookfield Congregational. I got in trouble this week because, there's a joy that goes with this, because Pat gave me a hard time because I didn't tell her about the picnic, and so I'll just share with everybody so it's not just on my shoulders. that I've been able to take her to a grocery store, been able to take her out to eat, and she is really quite mobile if you can handle her, her wheelchair, get into your car, and she is really quite mobile, and we need to include her in what we're doing, and I'll try to remember too, but she's really doing very well, and we're very happy. The baby's in NICU, he was only 5 pounds, but he's gonna be fine. He's named Victor after his grandfather.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Two things. We have friends who were in Lahaina, but had been having dinner on the other part of the island when the fires broke out. Were not able to get back into their condo. They since have done that, and they've been able to cut their, they are going to cut their vacation short and hoping to get home by the end of the, I think sometime next week. The other thing is, many of you remember Bob and Michelle May?
Yes.
Oh my gosh, they've become great grandparents. Oh my gosh, great grandparents. I am shocked. Anyway, the baby's name, this is Ashlyn, is the daughter of Derek and his wife, and the baby was 8 pounds, 12 ounces, and his name is Branch, as in the branch of a tree.
Lord, hear our prayers.
I know that many of you have heard the update on Ari, and for that we do praise God. But this next week is going to be very tumultuous for the family and for Ari. She's going to be leaving another safe place, not exactly the best place, but another safe place, and going to uncertainty again. I do believe that this is going to be the right spot for her, but just prayers for a peaceful transition over to another program.
Lord, hear our prayer. God is with you. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we come before you grateful for all the pleasant and glorious things that are taking place in our lives. Lord, we thank you for new births. We thank you for our first responders that will willingly and lovingly respond whenever they're called. We thank you for this boat that you have placed us in, that it may be, that we may find security from the world and its ways every time we walk through the door. Lord, as you know, things are also a challenge for so many. We ask you to watch over our brothers and sisters in Hawaii and keep them safe. May the resources that they need to reassemble their lives be flowing with love and peace and kindness from all over the country. Lord, we ask you to welcome our brothers and sisters that you called home into your arms. May they be surrounded by the love and the care that you promise us all. Lord, we ask you to watch over our friends and our brothers and sisters that are traveling. May they arrive at their destination safely, and may they find their way back home. Lord, there's so much happening in our world today. There's so much division. There's so much anxiety. And Lord, we need your peace here. We need your love and a better way of showing the world of what we can be and how we can be. Lord, we place our church before you, seeking your wisdom within her walls and your life within our hearts and minds. Lord, we seek peace for your children. May they gather in love and in kindness for one another. May we willingly just leave things alone sometimes, and that we may have a better way. Lord, as you know, this is not all we pray for. This is not all that sits on our hearts. So we ask you in this holy silence and in this moment to please read our hearts so that you know, as always, and we're aware of what's taking place within us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning will be Into My Heart, number 304. Please stand as you are able. Please be seated. Lord, as we depart from this sacred and safe space that you place us in, we ask that you help us to keep our eye on you and what is important in your ways. Lord, guide us to show the world that the light that you spread and you grow within us is available for all. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.